In this figure, we'll examine the male reproductive tract in a very schematic diagram, hoping to explain how it's a system of very complex and connected tubules. Now, the male gonad, the testes, develop within the abdominal cavity and pass across it, the abdominal wall shown here, right? We pass across that abdominal wall through a canal, the inguinal canal, and then the testes will actually reside in the scrotum, testes showing, being shown over here on the left. Now, in addition to the tubular connections of the reproductive tract itself, there would be blood vessels and lymphatics and nerves that cross this inguinal canal within what's called collectively the spermatic cord. Now, the testis itself is actually a compartmentalized system of very small convoluted tubules known as the seminiferous tubules. And this is where spermatogenesis takes place, the production of sperm. And there is more than a half mile of collective length of these seminiferous tubules. So hugely long and convoluted little tiny tubules along which sperm are being developed in cohorts such that the overall output of the seminiferous tubules appears continuous even though sperm are being developed at particular locations at particular times. And so this production occurs continuously and we end up with hundreds of millions of sperm being produced per day over the course of the adult lifespan. Now, if we take one of those seminiferous tubules and we cut it in cross-section, we can see its structure here. We've got the sperm on the inside here bracketed, right? That's the mature gamete cell. But it starts out here as a stem cell, as a germ cell, known as the spermatogonium. And that's the cell that's going to divide and differentiate to produce these numerous sperm cells. Now, there are the nurse cells, the Sertoli cells, and they form a barrier here. It's called the blood testis barrier. And the daughter cells of these germ cells have to pass across and divide and differentiate until we get to this viable sperm down here. Now, it's not swimming yet. Its flagellar action has not begun, but it's effectively fully mature. Lastly, we want to point out the gonads in both males and females are comprised of three main cell types, right? There's the germ cells, in this case, the sperm. There's the nurse cell, the Sertoli cell. But then there's the secretory cell, which in males is the Leydig cell. This is the cell that produces testosterone that will go off and have a myriad of effects in the male reproductive tract and elsewhere. But it's also going to be delivered into the seminiferous tubules to aid that spermatogenesis that's occurring there. Now, those sperm are going to pass through this lumen as they develop. They're going to exit through a convoluted structure of tubes called the reet testis into the efferent ducts that exits the testis. We now end up in a singular tube called the epididymis. This is a highly coiled small tube, sits right on top of the testis. It's about 20 feet long. The sperm are maturing further as they pass through here. They're non-motile on the way in, and about a week later, they're motile and functional on the way out of here. They become more concentrated by the actions of the epididymis. Then we pass out of the epididymis into the tube that actually takes us from adjacent to the testis all the way back into the abdomen and to the male reproductive tract. And that's the vas deferens. That's this tubule right here. And so that takes us through this inguinal canal. And the sperm can remain viable within this canal, within this tube for months. But during emission and ejaculation, those sperm would be released into the male urethra here and then be projectile ejaculated out of the penile urethra. Now, we have semen is not made up of just the germ cells. In fact, they make up a very small fraction of the actual volume. We have our accessory sex glands, the prostate. There's a singular prostate. There's two seminal vesicles. And then, of course, there's a pair of Cowper's glands as well. And they add secretions to those gamete cells as they're being released into the male urethra here through all these ducts. The male urethra actually passes through the prostate and through muscular contractions of the vas deferens and the lower muscles of the pelvic wall, we get propulsion, ejaculation of that contents during copulation. Now, we note that we're also connected to the bladder here, right? We share our reproductive tract with the urinary tract, and we certainly would not want our gametes to travel up into the bladder. That's called a retrograde ejaculation. And so during this ejaculation process, the neck of the bladder actually constricts. That causes everything to travel in the direction we want it to and out of the body.